workshop on December 4th. Any comments on that one? Okay, hearing none, I'll assume the minutes on the workshops are all right. Then I will ask on the draft minutes of our meeting on November 20th. Any comments on that?
Mr. Chairman?
Steve, yeah.
I'm usually not overly picky, but on page 5, in the 1, 2, 3, 4, 7th paragraph, only because it changes the meaning of the sentence. As Mr. Etzel said, we have to stray away from limiting it to this, and I think it should be stay away from.
Stay.
Or we could stay, as well.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, a typo on page 1, just above Spurwink Woods, that should refer to Ms. McKay rather than Mr. McKay.
Okay, we'll get you again, huh? Okay. Gotta get a Ms. and a Mr. right. Okay. Any others? Pardon, my eyes are getting old. Okay. Hearing none, do I hear a motion for acceptance of these minutes?
So moved.
So moved. Second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor? Opposed? We have a vote. We are going to be lacking one member until we have a replacement for Mr. Tinsman named. I haven't heard what the progress of that is with the personnel committee at this point in time. So what I'd like to do is name Mr. Emery as a voting member tonight for part of it, and we might get to a point where we have to appoint Ms. Ladner for part of it also. We'll start that way, okay? That takes care of the minutes. Correspondence. I've received some correspondence, which I think the committee has. Did the committee get a copy of the letter from Tom Leahy?
Yes,
this concerns questions that have been raised related to the health facility zone text change. We also received a letter. There's been numerous correspondence received on the health facility. I'm not going to go through all of them. We are going to have a hearing on this, but just suffice it to say that there has been a significant amount of correspondence on that issue, and will be entered into the minutes. We've also received a letter from Council Chair Cogswell relating to goal setting with some guidelines for us to use. I think that's a very timely letter since our next workshop in January. In addition to affordable housing, we're going to spend some time on the whole goal setting process. So I would just direct you to her letter and her the charts that are attached. They might be very helpful to us when we get into that workshop. We also received a letter from the council chair relating to land dedications, and I'll just paraphrase it. It came up also in the land use chairman's meeting a couple months ago, and it's just a note by other members of other boards. I'm not sure how widespread it is, but it's been noted that the dedication of open space has been, decisions on that seem to have been reached in advance of an applicant coming before the planning board. And if I can understand the sense of the letter, the sense is that these kinds of deliberations as to what should happen with the open spaces, whether it should go to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, whether it should be dedicated to the town, should be something that is part of the discussion with the developer in open session. So I think the letter is, once again, brings up an important point. I think it's something we should keep in mind as we review new applications coming in. We should be sensitive to how and why the land dedications have been made and in what format. So I would draw you to both those pieces of correspondence. So now, was there anything else in your correspondence you should be noting? Then at this time, I'd like to move on to our first item of business, and this concerns Stonegate Phase 4, 17-lot subdivision. It's a letter requesting extension of the preliminary plan review period, which is allowed under our ordinances, section 16-2-4A. Do you have anything to add to this at this point? I guess it would require a vote.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
As I have in the past, due to conflict of interest, I'll have to refrain from voting or discussing.
Okay. Ms. Lerner, could you take on? Okay. We have, I believe, a memorandum in our packet relating to this issue. I draw your attention to the memorandum dated December 18th versus subject Stonegate Phase 4 subdivision, and there's a motion there for us to consider. If there's no discussion on this issue prior to the motion, I might call for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that it be ordered that the applications for preliminary subdivision plan review, a wetlands alteration permit under pre-May 90 provisions, and a permit for construction in a resource protection district under the pre-May 1990 provisions for Stonegate Phase 4, a 17-lot major subdivision proposed by Stonegate Associates Incorporated and located off of Stonegate Road, be tabled to the regular March 1991 Planning Board meeting with the mutual agreement of both the applicant and the planning board.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion on this motion? Hearing none. All those in favor, signify by raising your right hand. Opposed? That motion carries, and we will correspond with Mr. Taylor that he has an extension to the March 1991 meeting. Next item on our agenda concerns Elizabeth Heights Retirement Community, construction of a 60-unit congregant care facility off Scott Dyer Road. This is a public hearing under our site plan review, Section 19-2-9 and 19-3-15 of our ordinances. At this time, I call this public hearing to order, and I would ask if there are any representatives of the developer present who can make a very short presentation for the purposes of bringing it to review before the public.
Yes, I'm here on behalf of...
Could you come to the front and identify yourself, sir?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name's Dan Horahan, and I'm with First Atlantic Corporation. Briefly, I've been before this board now for almost 5.5 years, and the last time I was formally before this board was back in '86, when we discussed a project which had a similar concept in use, but it contained almost 300 units. Since then, we've worked with the planning board in drafting an amendment to the RC zone, which would allow this type of use, which is congregate housing, independent living units for the elderly. What we have is a downsized project of 60 units on over 30 acres of land, which has supportive services for the elderly to allow the elderly to live an independent lifestyle with all the everyday backup that they need regarding meals, transportation, activities, and basic care services. And the project conforms with the ordinance as it was drafted over that 2-year period from '87 to '89. I want to just remind the board and the town that we have worked on this project for a long time. Now, we've invested a lot of time and sweat in this, and the town also, through its administrative staff and this board and predecessors who were on this board, have spent a lot of time coming up with this project, which we feel really fits the needs of the town. There is a market for this project, and we have a market study that we'll be submitting to you, an updated market study which shows that there is a market of great importance to this project. It's been downsized. We've had numerous sidewalks and meetings with the abutters and with the board to try to come up with a plan that fits everybody's needs. The building has been moved away from the Longfellow Ave area an additional 40 feet from what we originally proposed at a meeting, I think it was back in April. As we mentioned earlier, the building's been downsized to 60 units. We've had increased buffering along the Longfellow Drive area. We've done a visual impact study. Everything we've done over the last few months has been designed to minimize the visual impact, the mass of the project versus the abutters. And I think what we've come up with finally is a product that the town can really feel proud of, because it's a balancing of the interests of the community and having a quality care, independent living community, a project that the residents of Cape Elizabeth can occupy, as well as addressing the abutters' needs. And we feel that we have a project that really works in all fronts. And it's really due to the fact that the town, Steve Butler and Maureen O'Meara, have worked with us for years and years on trying to come up with a project that fits everybody's needs. And with that, we have with us tonight Kelly Harris, who's our project manager. Stan Garwin, architect, we have Bill Folger, Frank Cushing, and Mark Ray, our engineer, and we're here to answer any and all questions you may have about the project. But just to reiterate, we've been through a long haul with this as far as downsizing, buffering, moving the building, the actual site of the building, addressing all the wetlands. We did two wetland surveys. One of them we did on our own initiative. The other one was down at the request of this board. We had one done by EcoAnalyst and Woodwater Alternatives. The project addresses all the wetlands issues that are contained in the ordinance as this project applies to it. And we've done the buffering. We have open space. We're going to dedicate land to the land trust. We're going to donate land to the land trust. We're going to have an easement with the land trust, so we'll have public access. And I can't say enough how I'm standing here almost 5 years later, and I've personally been involved with this thing from the beginning, that we've really, you know, been through the whole process with the land trust people, the conservation people, this board, council, the zoning board of appeals, the abutters, and we have a project that you'll be proud of.
And with that, if you have any questions, we'll be free to feel free to answer them.
Thank you, Mr. Horan.
Thank you.
The public hearing process allows for a short presentation as just took place by the developer. The way we generally proceed next would be that we would entertain comments from the public. Now, the planning board is a regulatory type of body. We only take comments on projects in public hearings and public forum. So this is an important part of the whole process. So if you do have something to comment on this proposal, I would suggest that you raise your hand, come to the front, identify yourself, and make your statement. We will entertain as many statements as we can. We would like to see the statements be non-repetitive. We certainly hope that people will have different things to add. So we will try to get started on that basis, and we'd like to keep your statements as short as possible. So with that given, are there any comments from the public on this project? None? Sir, please.
You'll have to bear with me. I'm a little bit nervous and not used to standing in front.
Sir, could you just identify yourself?
Group like this. My name is Benson Dana, and I live at 17 Orchard Road.
17 Orchard Road.
Yeah, in the Elizabeth Park area.
Mm-hmm.
I have basically three areas of concern points. The first one concerns the size of the building and, more directly, the height of the building. I'm curious as to why the building has to be three stories, and I think the height of the building is something that is probably the largest concern to me. The thing is just, it's literally massive, but what really has a significant effect is the height, the three stories. And especially if you compare it to something like the Viking Nursing Home, one story, or the Cape Colonial Village, once again, one and a half story buildings. All the other buildings in the area are one and a half story in Elizabeth Park, and basically two story maximum across the road in the entire Brentwood neighborhood. So I'm concerned about the height, and more specifically, as shown in the plans from the developers, they give a kind of a picture of the height of the development compared to a typical house in the neighborhood if you're standing in the middle of Longfellow Drive, and they indicate that the height of the building is equal to the height of the house at an angle of 17 degrees. Well, I believe the winter sun gets about to 14 degrees height above the horizon. And I think what this basically says is that a number, if not most of the houses along there are going to have the winter sun, especially the trees have no leaves. The winter sun's going to be blocked out of the entire of the houses along that Longfellow Drive. Because of the height of the building and because of the way it's situated and the drawings that the developer has given us with that 17 degrees, I think that's a significant impact. If you take away somebody's winter sun, that doesn't give us much in the state of Maine. We have very little as it is. So I have a serious problem with the three stories and the height of the building. A one-story, two-story maximum development would be just scads better. It just would be unbelievable, the difference in that respect. Another point along that, and I'm addressing specifically site plan regulations, the building and parking area layout and design, section 3, where it talks about the impact on the surrounding developments and the contiguous buildings and lands. So these comments are addressed directly to that section. And also to section 6, environmental considerations, protection of significant vistas, and minimizing adverse effects. So I think my comments are related directly to those portions of the site plan regulations. I'd also like to point out in the developer's packet the pictures presented for the to give an idea of the site impact have the trees full of leaves, and that's about 6 months of the year. I think I'd like to see the a similar impact projection at this time of year with the leaves gone. I think it would be a significant difference, and once again, that's not a minor point, that's 6 months of the year around here. That's my first point. The second point, I guess I have to start with a question. Is the financial condition of a developer relevant to a site plan review? I don't know.
Financial condition is a point, yes.
Is it? Has the planning board requested a Dun & Bradstreet review of First Atlantic?
I would have to ask that question, okay? We'll have to ask that question.
You will, okay. I would request that you do request, that you do obtain a Dun & Bradstreet review of First Atlantic Corporation. I've got a copy here. Unfortunately, I cannot share it with you because of the way Dun & Bradstreet works its business. But the town of Cape Elizabeth can request its own from Dun & Bradstreet. And I think what's in there is very germane. If the financial condition of the corporation, the specific corporation, which is First Atlantic, is a consideration. That's my second point. My last point regards the wetland ordinance that the developer mentioned and the fact that this project complies with the applicable wetland ordinance. I believe in my review or following this that he's referring to the pre-May 1990 wetlands ordinance. There was a superseding wetlands ordinance passed, I believe, in May of 1990. And I understand that the planning board received a legal opinion as to whether or not this development was grandfathered under the old wetlands ordinance. And it's my understanding that that one legal opinion indicated that, yes, it was. I'm aware of a letter sent to the planning board dated May 21st that provides a different opinion, a directly opposite opinion. And I guess I have to ask what the liability to the town might be if there was a mistake made in the initial legal opinion. And if, in fact, as lawyers can make mistakes, that if this development does, in fact, need to comply with the new wetlands ordinance, I think that needs to be discovered more definitely now that the planning board knows there is a potential conflict here, as early in the process as possible, because the damage done as the developer proceeds, if speculatively a suit is brought by somebody challenging the opinion that, and this does not in fact comply with the new wetlands ordinance, that may be a significant liability for all concerned. So I'd ask that the planning board get another legal opinion, considering the May 21st letter from the citizens, to just I'd like to see two legal opinions of the same out of three. I guess I have one last point. Are there Department of Environmental Protection permits required for this project? Once again, this is a question I don't know. And following up, if there are DEP permits required, have they been submitted?
Any other questions?
No, I think that does it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to invite questions from the public all at once, so we avoid the developer bouncing back and forth here between. So I'll hold these questions until we get through with all the public comment, and then we'll ask the developer to come up and try to address as many of these as he can. Any other questions from the public on this? Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Richard Fortinsky. I'm a resident of 33 Longfellow Drive. I wish to direct my comments to one clause in the Housing for the Elderly ordinance and then to four of the land use regulation standards. First of all, the Housing for the Elderly ordinance regards the market feasibility study. Mr. Horahan did mention that the applicant will be submitting a market feasibility study. I believe that the applicant study must include two items which may not be considered a regular part of a market feasibility study, but which you, if you as a planning board wish to set an example for local concern about the care and dignity of older citizens, potential residents of this community, that you ought to require of the applicant in this market feasibility study. The first issue concerns specifying the real target population for this retirement community. We have heard language from the applicant such as this is targeted toward the slow-go population of the elderly as opposed to the no-goes and the go-goes. We have heard this a couple of times. As far as I'm concerned, and I am involved in conducting research and development of services for older people, and I've been to retirement communities across the country, the definition as slow-goes, if that's acceptable to you, I don't think really does justice to exactly who it is this community is targeted toward. What exactly will be the screening criteria for older adults who are going to be accepted into this retirement community? What will be considered screening criteria for admission? And I think more importantly, what will be considered screening criteria for denial? I really do not think that the applicant has been at all specific about the target population of older adults. It is considered independent living, however, there are supportive services. I don't know exactly how that will be reconciled if it's independent living with supportive services. They seem to be contradictory statements to me. I think the town should demand to know how disabled will be too disabled to move in based on some kind of standard criteria that are used by retirement communities elsewhere throughout the country. I think this is especially true now that we're only dealing with an independent living component and that the assisted living component of this facility has been basically deleted from the plan. We're either talking about independent living or nothing for this plan. A second issue, which is certainly as important, is how will transfer decisions be made for people once they are living in this retirement community? When will someone be considered too frail or too disabled to continue living there? And what will the criteria be to define when a person becomes too frail? I believe this is a critical issue in this retirement community because once this community is well underway, there will be decisions made, and I admit that there are some clinical criteria involved here and that physicians and nurses and such must be involved in these decisions. However, I think the planning board has a responsibility to consider upfront, before this facility is well underway, about how citizens will be treated once they are in the facility and let's say their health begins to deteriorate. I think that that's a very, very reasonable question to consider in a market feasibility study. Retirement communities throughout the country are dealing with this issue all the time. I have been to retirement communities where the issue about transferring from one level of living to another is a major issue. And I think that you will basically be setting a standard for other locales that are considering retirement communities, and you will be forward-thinking as a planning board if you really think on behalf of the older citizens who may be moving in about exactly how these decisions might be made. So I would simply request that those two particular components be included in the market feasibility study. Now I'd like to turn to a couple of the land use regulations. The first one, a couple of these may sound a bit redundant of what Mr. Dana said, however, I do have some comments in that regard, particularly as we are an immediate abutting property owner. The first is the building and parking area design and layout. I have looked over the visual impact analyses, and the spatial experience profiles place the observer in the middle of Longfellow Drive, and then consider the angle from the middle of Longfellow Drive. Well, I think what's more realistic to those of us who live immediately adjacent to this property is estimating the impact from the backyard of those residences, or at least from the inside rear of our building, for example, from the window of our family room as we look west. That visual impact, I think, would be much more dramatic than the visual impact that you currently have from the viewpoint of someone in the middle of Longfellow Drive. And I refer specifically to Exhibits 6 and 7 of the visual impact analysis. A small point about visual simulation number 2 in that analysis, which is Exhibit 10. That exhibit does not include the parking lot. It does not include the very high streetlights that will be part of that community. It simply includes the building. And as Mr. Dana said, it includes trees which have leaves on them. But that's just one point of many issues, many items that are deleted from that particular visual impact. I think when you add the parking lot, you add the streetlights to the building, the visual impact from a drawing perspective would be much more dramatic. So to summarize this particular regulation, I just question whether, based on the visual analyses that you have as part of the application, whether you can really appreciate the true impact of this structure on the abutting property owners on the west end of Longfellow Drive. It's not at all in keeping with the surrounding development, which again is a clause in the building and parking area design and layout regulation. And we believe that that deserves a much, much closer look. So what I would recommend is to repeat the visual impact analysis now that the trees are bare, and also to conduct the analysis from the rear of the residences rather than from the middle of Longfellow Drive. I would welcome you to do it from the back of our yard, 33 Longfellow Drive. And at the very least, I think what you may conclude is that perhaps the building ought to be moved farther west on the site to compensate for the proposed height of this building and the impact that that's going to have on those of us who live in those residences. And then I also have a question relating to the height about the unoccupied space that is currently proposed to be approximately the top 8 to 10 feet of that structure. I simply question why that unoccupied space has to be there. I realize it's a design feature. I appreciate the architectural features of the structure. However, it is a design feature. It is not a functional part of the building. And by removing the 8 to 10 feet, and I'm approximating here, of the building, the top of the building that's unoccupied space, I think that would greatly reduce the untoward visual impact of this particular building on the surrounding development. The second land use regulation is the environmental considerations regulation. And here, there's simply the phrase protection of significant vistas. And this is a bit redundant from what Mr. Dana said. However, our particular vista is going to be completely eliminated by this building. If you take a look at where our particular property is, not only will we lose the afternoon sun during the winter, as Mr. Dana already stated, but we're going to lose our sunsets all year round. And that's not being dramatic. That's absolutely true. Regarding land use regulation, regarding lighting, we want to emphasize the regulation about lighting really specifies the directional lights on the property, but it does not really specify the impact of the headlights that are going to be beaming in as cars circulate around the driveway that's proposed. And we just basically really demand that the buffer construction consider all lighting aspects of this particular facility, not just the directional lights, not just the 16-foot pole lights, but also all the various directions where the headlights are going to be moving as the cars circulate that driveway and as they park and move out of the parking lot in the dark, the nighttime hours. And just a minor point is that the tall street lights are not always indicated on some of the visual impact analyses, and I think that they should be added as well. Sometimes just the parking lot and the street layout is. I think it would be very important to include the street lights and their location on all of the all of the drawings for the visual impact. And then finally, I'd like to just address the buffering issue, since that obviously relates to some of the visual impact items I've been talking about. The first recommendation based on the visual impact analysis, if you remember looking through that document, targets the residences 19 Longfellow Drive through 41 Longfellow Drive as those being in the greatest need of buffering. That's clearly their top recommendation. What I request, not only on behalf of myself and my family, but on behalf of those targeted residents, is that we get a guarantee as part of this project to select the types, the initial height, and the placement of all buffer vegetation adjacent to our properties. And secondly, we also want to guarantee that plantings will occur first. In other words, that the landscaping is done along that buffering zone, along those properties, before construction begins. I have a couple of very practical reasons for this. The first one is to preserve the resale value of any of our houses during the construction phase. If at least the landscaping and the buffering has been completed before the construction starts, and some of us have to show our properties in order to sell it, at least we will be able to demonstrate that the buffering is already there and the prospective purchasers are not looking at the shell of a building or a bunch of construction equipment without any kind of a buffer. And then the second issue is purely an economic issue. If the applicant completes the project, completes the structure, and waits to do the landscaping until the end, as is usually done, it may really be an issue of delaying the landscaping at that point, simply because the applicant may not be in a financial position at that point to complete the landscaping. That may not be an issue, but we want to make sure that it's not an issue. So again, I just cannot specify strongly enough that we want all buffering completed before the construction begins on this project. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Fortinsky. Any other comments from the public? Yes, please. And I would once again, please try to keep the comments as short as possible and non-repetitive.
My name is Lori Fear, and I live at 58 Scott Dyer Road. And I'm here to talk about the impact of the added traffic that this project will cause. Scott Dyer Road, as I'm sure you all know, is the home of our elementary school and our middle school, a new playground, and several playing fields. At this point, right now, the mile-per-hour zone is 25. However, I know that some of you live near that neighborhood, and you know that most people go 35 to 50 miles per hour on this road. Added traffic, although the developers say that it's not going to be significant, of any kind, there'll be delivery trucks, there'll be visitors, there'll be residents, some going back and forth. Added traffic on this road is going to cause more impact to a problem that is already there, and that is that there's too much traffic going down Scott Dyer Road as it is, and it's going too fast. And one of the things that I'd like to ask, well, first of all, one of the things I have to ask first is, at one point, I believe that you have to ask about alternate uses of the facility if the use that they're talking about using it for now does not pan out. And if the use becomes a regular apartment building or some other type of thing, what is that going to do to the traffic on Scott Dyer? As a property owner on that street, I am concerned that more traffic is going to change the tone of this residential area to the point where the town will may be forced to consider widening the street, which will destroy our property values, especially on the side that I am on, which is the Elizabeth Park side, where our front yards are not that large to begin with. I also have an elm tree that sits on the edge of my property, which I don't want destroyed. What I'd like to ask you to do is to consider a beefed up, if you approve this property, to consider a beefed up police monitoring of the traffic on Scott Dyer and make sure that people do pay attention to the mile per hour zone. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Normally at this time, what we would do is move to planning board questions, but before we do that, so we don't get too far away from the questions that were asked, I'd like to have the developer come forward, if he could, and address some of the questions that I've taken notes on, and I'd like to have our planner maybe address some of the questions on procedure that were asked. We'll get to those.
If I
can get back to all of them, and maybe some of the other members of the board would help me out if I've taken notes that are incorrect. Mr. Dana asked some questions that centered around the issues of height and sun shading and design of the building, and specifically questioned the way the site was shown with leaves on the trees, financial capability, and wetlands ordinance. Those were three that he asked. Maybe you could start with those, and we could help out in some places.
First of all, dealing with the financial stability of First Atlantic. First Atlantic is a privately held corporation, and I don't know what kind of report he has in his possession, but Dun & Bradstreet is typically something that is it's a report that's done to publicly traded companies where there's full public disclosure of financial information. If you check with any of the financial institutions in Portland, they'll tell you they were probably the strongest development company in Greater Portland. We have, as subsidiary companies, which are not part of First Atlantic, but we have a chain of 17 pharmacies. We have a home health company with 5 locations throughout the state. We own and operate 6 nursing homes. We have approximately 400,000 square feet of space with a 7% vacancy throughout the state, which is probably the best that anyone has in Maine right now. So I don't know what kind of information he has in his possession, but I can assure you we can give you the appropriate references from any bank in town. But as a privately held company, no one really can have access to our financial information, so that's why he probably doesn't have one.
Any business with a financial consideration can request a Dun & Bradstreet report, and that includes any municipality. So the fact that you're a private corporation, probably 90% of the companies reporting to Dun & Bradstreet are private corporations. Until 1954, 55, Ford Motor Company was a private organization, private company. So the fact that it's a private company doesn't mean that they can't or shouldn't.
I think I'd like to limit rebuttal back and forth between individuals. On this financial capability point of view, we'll take that under advisement. Our housing ordinance for the elderly has certain provisions, not as many as in some other areas. Mr. Hornahan has offered to make available to us references from his bank and so on, and we would take that into advisement. So I think we'll cover that issue that way. Maybe we can move on to the next issue concerning the heights of the building.
Regarding the DEP, the project does not require DEP site plan approval because it is exempted due to the fact that it is less than 100,000 square feet. And I may not have all these criteria to memory, but 100,000 square foot building, 3 acres or more of impervious area, and I believe a 60,000 square foot footprint are the three criteria that would have generate DEP site plan review. So we don't require that review at this point in time. Dealing with the visual impact study, I guess the reason there are leaves on the trees is because you know, we've been pushing this project from the very beginning as hard as we could, and the timing was that this board requested us to do a visual impact study during the spring and summer months, and we wanted to get it done as soon as possible. So that's why there are leaves on the trees. It's as simple as that. There's no other reason for that other than that's just what time of year it was, and you wanted the study done, so, and we wanted to get the project moving along. Regarding, and there were other comments regarding what the ordinance says regarding market study and requirements regarding who is the purpose of the project. I'd like to remind the board that over a 3-year period, there were numerous public workshops, public hearings held regarding the language that was contained in the ordinance that was, or the amendment to the RC zone, which dealt with every single one of those issues. And I was present at some workshops where there were other members of the public present. And there were public hearings held at the planning board when they voted to recommend whether or not to recommend to the council that the ordinance be amended, and I believe the town council had a public hearing on the issue of what kind of language was contained in that ordinance and what
kind of input the public may have. So what I'd suggest is that I think it was probably over 2 years' worth of time when the public had open access and opinions. They could have come in and spoke to the town about what should be contained in the market study information. And I would suggest that it wouldn't do the town or any of us any good to delay the whole process by bringing up issues which should have been dealt with at the appropriate time. Regarding taking care of patients that may or may not be suitable for the facility, we own and operate a number of nursing homes in the area, and the Viking Nursing Home is situated right next to the project. I see Duane very cordial around the Fed here this evening, and I know they have a project before you also, but we've had informal discussions with them about having an arrangement between the two facilities. We currently are developing a nursing home with assisted and skilled. I guess as of now, they no longer are any skilled and intermediate care. It's called OBRA. All kinds of nursing home patients are treated the same, and they're not classified differently. We have an assisted care nursing home in Bangor. We have nursing homes throughout Greater Portland. So we do have 30 years experience in giving care to elderly patients in a nursing home setting. As of this point, our plan is to have an arrangement with one of our other facilities in the area. We're planning an assisted wing in Freeport and perhaps in Falmouth. We have a nursing home in Falmouth and we have one in Freeport. So the timing of this project would coincide with either a planned assisted care wing in one of those facilities. I have to refer to Rick Patinsky, who is probably happens to be an expert on long-term care, has a great deal more experience than I do in this area. And I believe, as a layman, that we have nursing home beds, assisted care, and independent living units, and we'll be able to provide a full spectrum of care to those residents. As far as the specifics of what would cause a resident to be discharged or to remain in the facility, I don't see those as site plan issues, and if they were to be inserted as part of the ordinance, I think that should have been done during the two-year public input process on the drafting of that ordinance. And I would also, you know, say that if you could check with Department of Human Services regarding our reputation for providing care, we probably have the best reputation for providing quality care in the state of Maine of any nursing home chain that's ever existed in the state. And I'll give you some names at a later date that you can call people with the Department of Human Services in Maine. So we have an open book as far as, or an open hand regarding our quality of care that we have delivered, we will continue to deliver in the state of Maine. As far as our financial stability and ability to bring the project to fruition, it's the same thing. With that, I don't really know what else I can tell you other than, you know, giving you the references and the names at a later date if you want them, and you can check into those issues. There was another question regarding the traffic. We had a recent traffic study done that showed 13 cars at peak hour traffic coming and going to the facility. That's additional cars over what's currently traveling on Scott Dyer Road. And I believe the planning board has a copy of that revised traffic study, which was done in October. Again, I know that it's a controversial project because people who live next to it have concerns about the mass and the bulk, but I just want to remind you how much we've downsized it and how far we've come in this process. And we have met with the abutters and done sidewalks with the abutters and this board with the idea of walking and looking at where our house is in relation to our project and saying, okay, we'll buffer here, and this is with, and we've walked every inch of this. I think it was December 1st, I walked with some of these board members and we actually walked the whole road, and we were concerned about headlights and impact on the abutters, and you know, I feel that we've really done a fair job and reasonable job in addressing the concerns, but I think what we're talking about is a balancing project, balancing process here to come up with a project that works. Our market study is completed. I have a draft copy tonight which shows that there is a demand for this, and the market study was done in conformance with the clause in the ordinance which was adopted, which required a market study. To change the rules would be kind of onerous now because we've already gone a great deal of expense in generating a market study. So, I want to look to your fairness on that issue. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. At this time, are there any other comments from the developer at this point? Are there any other comments from the public? Yes, sir.
I'm Linda Wakefield. Mm-hmm. I live at 15 Dearborn Drive, which is across the street from the proposed development.
That was Dearborn Drive?
Dearborn Drive, that's correct. I think we have to look that this is private land that will be developed. I think a lot of people would like it not to be, but I feel it's going to be at some time. And of all the alternative uses, this seems to be a use that is needed, that would have very little impact on services, especially our schools, would have no impact. I feel the developer has also, in the 5 years of the planning, has worked very hard to meet the demands of this board, of abutters, and try to work with them instead of ramrodding their ideas through. And I just felt somebody had to show the other side of the coin. Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, are there any other questions from the public or from the comment or from the developers?
Yes, I'd like to respond to a few comments that were made in hopes that we might be able to explain a few things about the impact analysis and perhaps the height of the building and some buffering.
Okay.
My name is Frank Cushing. I'm with Gar and Associates. I think what people have been referencing in the analysis in terms of the exhibit or the common spatial experience in Elizabeth Park and a viewpoint from the center line of Longfellow Drive, I believe that to be the common experience of the people living there. I believe the people that abut our project to the west is the exception and not the rule within the development. That relationship was not demonstrated in this analysis. I know Rick requested a section through the site. We have that today, actually. If you want me to put that up, or I can give you a copy of it so you can understand the relationships there. There was a number of comments made about the relationship of loss of sunlight. I think you're being over dramatic on it. We've gone through an analysis of the shadow patterns in the building for the winter solstice, the summer solstice, and the equinox, and we can put that up here. It does have, I think that we're talking probably loss of sunlight at various times of the year, an hour before sunset. And it will vary through the year. We know that sun travels a different path in the sky every day. What you're looking at is the ridge line of the structure. It's tallest location, it's going to be the furthest shadow from the building. It indicates that there will be a shadow path in that arc. And it gets home number 37, 35.
Excuse me, Frank. Could you tell everyone which way north is so we can get oriented?
Yes, of course. North is in this direction and page. This property line is very close to due south. The statements of loss of sunlight for many of the residents here for most of the day is simply not true. You're looking at, as I mentioned, roughly an hour before sunset for various homes at various times of year. It's a really a complicated issue to study the sun angles and the structure. There's a lot of variables here. This does not indicate trees between the home and the proposed building, and it doesn't take into account the varying heights of these homes. You know, they step up and down the hill here. The homes, the finished floors fall from 40 down to mid-20s in the lower portion. There was comments made about our simulations and why they didn't show pavements and street lights all. Granted, the street lights should probably be on there, but neither did we show landscaping or fencing. Now, if you go and you show your landscaping and fencing from off-site views, it's a wash. It wasn't shown. I believe the issues here are for the intended purpose of this analysis to demonstrate the height of the building in relationship to the site. They didn't pay a lot of attention to the pavements and ground planes. We can certainly overlay those for you. With regard to the defoliated season, I think in your analysis we did, well, there was quite a debate in preparing this, how we would show that, whether we would run two sets of simulations simultaneously. It would have meant delaying our photography, because this is all keyed into the actual physical targets on the site. I believe I'm lucky enough to have a black and white copy, but if you have a color copy, you can see the extension of the structure, which we've outlined in here, so that would certainly be visible to people in the season. And that was shot from, number 25, I believe that is. And I do have an overlay for this simulation, which shows the structure during the defoliated season, which will overlay over the foliated site. They don't have an enlargement of this for defoliated site, although I do have the photography of the site almost 2 years ago during March. So I have all the photography if you want to look at that. I think after hearing many of the comments here tonight, particularly in regard to this visual analysis, visual impact to specific residents in the neighborhood, and the landscape issue, I think the community of the neighborhood and First Atlantic Corporation probably best served with another meeting. I don't believe this is the forum to establish agreements of what is planted where. That has to be worked out between you folks and us. And we need to sit down and do that. I think we can achieve your goals and our goals. I believe that to be true.
Did you have anything else to add, sir? We are getting short on time. Thank you. Any other comments? This time I'd close the regular public hearing. Is there something in the back row that wanted to say something? Oh, okay. I'm sorry. It's your hand. Would you please identify yourself, sir?
Robert Cummings, Eddie Scott Dyer. The driveway coming into the project comes in right beside my house at Eddie Scott. And I'd like to know what the developer plans to do to buffer my house from the lights coming in from the west and from the noise of the vehicles coming in of my driveway, or the driveway going in there.
Sir, have you seen the latest plan on that? No. The earlier plan showed it coming in very close to your house. The later plan, it's further away. Maybe the developer could help point that out.
Here. I do plan to do planting in this area.
Evergreen.
Yeah, there'd be white pines.
At this point, sir, what I would suggest on that, we're getting into details that this is really not the forum for. I would suggest you be invited to the meeting where buffering is discussed, and maybe you provide your input to the developer directly on that point. But I would also suggest you go out and take a look at the stakes that are in there for the new road and see, so you can visually see for yourself how close it is.
Okay, what about ambulance service coming out there? They're going to have their sirens on when they come in and out?
I'm not sure what the story is there.
I mean, I sleep right there, right next to the...
Yeah.
That's my bedroom, right in the corner.
Well, any time we've ever had rescue service at our other facilities, which are heavier care facilities, sirens aren't usually going. Yeah.
That may have been an issue also that was discussed at the zoning board.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Any other issues before the board here? At this point, I'll close the public hearing and open questions from the planning board on this application to the applicant. Any questions?
excuse me. Are we allowed to make comments as well as ask questions?
Sure.
Shall I start?
Let's go ahead.
Thank you. I think generally in responding to the butter's concerns, we ask ourselves several questions in this process. First of all, is the proposal consistent with a comprehensive plan? To the best of my knowledge, it certainly is. And does it meet the basic requirements of space and bulk of the ordinance? To the best of my knowledge, it does, with perhaps the exception of how the height of the building is interpreted. And I think that's one thing that I would ask Maureen to confirm with the code enforcement officer one more time. If in fact BOCA is the sole regulation for determining height restrictions in buildings, and if we're all at the same time assuming that 35 feet is the height, I don't think that's necessarily the case here. Comments from our last site walk, generally, I think the question about why is the building located where it is in terms of its proximity to the abutters, first of all, it's further away than it has to be in terms of side yard setback. On the other hand, there appears to be a high knoll in the location where the building is adjacent to the, or closer to the abutters, and perhaps shifting it a little to the west would benefit both the project as well as the abutters. I think that's a detailed design issue, but something that is worthy of further investigation. In terms of the building's overall height and the additional 8 to 10 feet, I think whenever one has to trade off building design improvements such as sloped roofs, things that generally give a lot of scale to a building, make them more in keeping with the adjacent uses, designers, architects are inevitably faced with that conflict. We have a building height of restriction of 35 feet or whatever it is, and if I slope this roof at a minimum percent that looks good, something that doesn't look like a manufactured house, then I'm above that. Which do people prefer? Do they prefer to have the height in keeping architecturally, or do they want an absolute limit? I think generally the building form and configuration is consistent with an architecture that's appropriate to the area, and that the 8 to 10 feet, if it can be taken out of the height, out of the building, I would say terrific, but I wouldn't want to sacrifice the general architectural quality of the building to reduce the height. In terms of the impact on sunsets and views to the west, I'm very sensitive to that issue because I, in fact, live in a subdivision nearby and have very few of those. In this case, the impact is from trees on adjacent streets, and being a landscape architect myself, it's one of those inevitable dilemmas that one faces in life where you don't want to lop off the tops of the trees, really, do you? In this case, the abutters have enjoyed for many years views to the west, sunsets, and at the same time, those have been afforded over somebody else's property. What is a reasonable impact for this board to consider in terms of approving or not approving this project? Again, going back to the ordinance, is it consistent with the height restrictions of the ordinance? has the developer taken reasonable care in siting the building and orienting it? I think, again, if it were moved slightly to the west, it would be helpful. I have as many concerns about the actual impact on the project, that is, that the entrance faces north, that many of the units are oriented to the north, and in fact, those may be more difficult to market than ones that may be oriented east-west. The dilemma there, obvious to everyone, is that the building then is elongated along the abutting property line, and there's additional impact on the neighbors. So I think those two options have been discussed at various meetings, and perhaps with some finer adjustments to the building's locations, we are where we are. In terms of headlights, this struck me. If you could please go back to the original site plan, if you could just flip those.
No, the other way. There.
For people who are in the audience or at home who aren't familiar with the wetland configurations on this site, the driveway responds very closely to the setback requirements of the wetlands. And this board is here to regulate the town ordinances determining wetlands. In my heart, I wonder what are we trading off when we save a group of alders and place a road closer to an abutting property line. But as a member of the planning board, it's not my role to make that discretion. The ordinance has been met. But I do feel very much concerned about the abutters' issues regarding buffering. In our last site walk, it seemed clear that there was a lot of consideration given to buffering, that is, that the applicant had gone from lot to lot, that this wasn't something that was done in office and simply put on the plan as a tree stamp. There's also consideration for relocating indigenous plant materials on the site rather than just coming in with nursery-grown stock. Much of that plant material is not evergreen, but will, during the winter months, provide through its density of branching and twig structure some screening. However, I think if we hear anything from the abutters, it's really this concern for buffering, and I feel a lot of concern of this application leaving the planning board without some sort of a plan that states what will be and what will not be provided in terms of buffering. It's extremely arbitrary for an abutter to be able to sit down with a developer at the time of construction and say, I will have a tree that's such and such height, I'll have a shrub that's such and such a height. I think it serves everyone much better, and in fact is less arbitrary, if at least the quantity of plant materials and general locations can be assigned in concept on the plan. We as a planning board know then what the applicant is supposed to provide. What that will mean is that in the best case of Rick's comments, in the best of all worlds, if we were to follow his suggestion, we may go out there and find a lot of 12-foot evergreens located to meet his specific views. In the worst case, what would happen if we were to follow that is a developer would, in fact, only have to provide what the ordinance requires and come along, some 5-foot trees. So I would suggest that those trees, their heights and general locations be assigned on the plan. If the developer would like to sit with the abutters and sort of come to consensus on that, perhaps that's appropriate. And in terms of concern about the timing of those placement of those trees, a concern I would have that if they're placed prior to construction, they may not survive the construction period. This would be a fairly long construction period, and the placing of trees may not be consistent with the time in which it would be appropriate to the construction phasing. But what could possibly be done is that trees could be treated as a public improvement, and I'd ask Maureen to provide input on this. And perhaps they could be bonded as a public improvement, just like street improvements and other improvements. And there would be a guarantee and a bond submitted. Even if the developer left town, the money for the trees would be there, and they would ultimately be installed. Uh, One of the abutters brought up an issue that I think is worthy of noting, and that's the alternate use impact. I must say that I'm not well versed in that part of the ordinance, but it does occur to me that perhaps I believe the issue here is that if the project is not successful as an elderly care facility, that it could be converted to apartments, and that those would be of greater number than the elderly units, fewer, 29. Would those, in fact, be apartments, or would they be condominiums?
Condominium is merely a form of ownership of an apartment unit, so I'm not sure that distinguishing between the two would really deal with the use of the property.
Is there any distinction in terms of whether DEP would, or whether the community would, either one, DEP would look at this as a project because it has greater than so many units being transferred into ownership, or would the community, and I would ask Maureen this question, consider it differently because it would then become a subdivision?
I'm not aware of any criteria that would trigger a different type of review. I think that there's a law dealing with condominium conversion which requires the filing of the condominium documents with the municipality. It's a declaration, mm-hmm. and the formation of that association. I believe the ordinance has a limitation on people occupying the units being over, I believe it's 62 years old. In the state of Maine, it is not deemed to be discriminatory practice to exclude people from living in a project if they are less than 62 years of age. And I can't recall whether that's in this ordinance, but we've had discussions, and I would be willing to limit the occupants of the project to being older than 60. It's either 62 or 63, but there is a state law that says that you can discriminate, in fact, and keep people out of a project if you want it to be an elderly project if they're less than 62 years old. So we could have that condition attached to it.
One final comment. I'm sorry to take so long. The issue of the elm tree I heard that there's one at the abutting property line, but the one that's really a hallmark is the one that's a specimen is the one that's located dead center on the property line on Scott Dyer Road. There were some discussions during the sidewalk. It would be very important to me that the sidewalk that's eventually constructed does whatever it has to do in order to avoid the roots of that elm tree.
Yes. I've recently had the survey crew out, and we're doing a section through that to find the best location for that sidewalk, or least disruptive to that tree. I believe it will be down inside the project and would work with an easement, I guess, as a vehicle for maintenance. That sidewalk out of the right-of-way and onto the property, away from the tree.
Is that that's Mr. Emery there? Any other comments? Mr. Edsel?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Following up on one of the questions that Mr. Emery asked, it wasn't clear your answer. What form of ownership the people will have in the units?
Oh, it'll be a rental program.
It'll be a rental program. They have no fee or condominium interest in the property?
No, they don't.
Okay.
Oh, I thought he was concerned about another use down the road of being apartments versus condominium. But
that was my concern.
Okay. I think it might be worthwhile for our planner to check into the federal law on discrimination. They added the familial clause dealing with families and ages. It would certainly take precedent over the state law.
What our ordinance states is that anyone who comes in under the housing for the elderly provisions has to guarantee that most, if not all, of the project will be open to elderly households. Elderly households is defined in the ordinance as someone, you have to have at least one person in the household that's 62 years of age or older.
But can't necessarily state that they can't have somebody under a certain age.
That's right.
That's right.
So
So to add to that, if indeed the project ceased to exist in the form and it was suggested it now become a condominium, that would be a change of use under this ordinance, and we'd have to come back for a review by this board. So it wouldn't be an automatic thing in any case. Sorry?
That's right.
Secondly, and I had talked to Maureen before the meeting started about adding requests for information, and our statute provides for us to ask for additional information, and it had to do specifically with under our minor and major subdivision review that we can ask for financial capacity or capability of the applicant. And I think I'd just throw it out to the board to reach some type of consensus in the site plan review. Are we in a situation with the size of this and perhaps one later this evening where we make it a request, the applicant indicant that he could supply it with that. I think we have a municipal responsibility to at least review that in the minor and in major subdivision requirements for site plan review. It states financial capacity as a firm financial commitment. I think, and I'd like to hear a little bit of discussion if the board thinks that that's a prudent thing to do. It would be my indication that it would be. Under buffering, the only, and then there is some significant buffering in the planning, and I would just like to make sure that the developer or the applicant is considering the species that you're choosing, that 10 years from now, that species, you mentioned white pine, it hasn't outgrown its height use and no longer is useful for that purpose, and it's some type of species that stays at a moderate height and provides for long-term buffering. And I just one short comment on the feasibility study, which we're marketing feasibility study, which I understand you have a rough draft and you will be supplying it to us. Again, I think it's a municipal responsibility that, and I hear it constantly, being in the lending business, that the two parties, both the municipalities and lending institutions, bear a lot of responsibility for the amount of development that's been taking place in the last decade. I think it's our responsibility here to review that quite closely.
Thank you, Mr. Edson. Any other comments? Yes.
Just a few.
Okay.
I was noting under the question of financial capacity, I think that Mr. Edsel just probably mentioned sometimes, particularly these days when stranger things than you've ever seen are happening in the commercial field of who's doing what, sometimes it's not the developer that has the trouble, it's his lender. So there's there's really a lot more to look at now than just knowing you have a really good banking relationship. It is the making sure that what gets started gets finished, and it might not always be, again, your fault or someone's fault, the developer's fault. I wanted to say I agreed with virtually with everything that Tom said, and I think for the public would reiterate the fact that the planning board reviews a project in terms of the comprehensive plan and the ordinances, and those are the rules. If we don't like the ordinance or we don't like the plan, that's really where it needs to be changed. We put a subjective kind of oversee to make sure it gets done well. We really put a lot of faith in a developer who works well with the neighbors. And I know for myself, a developer who really puts himself out to meet with the neighbors and to do everything that he can and means a great deal to me as a planning board member. But there's always the fact that if they meet all the criteria of the ordinances and the view of the comprehensive plan, we kind of have to see it from that. I would imagine that First Atlantic, seeing that the buffering issue is going to be obviously one of the major points, will work very closely with you. I remember the first project that I worked on in this board, which was Meadowview, and it was the issue that came back again and again and again, was the buffering, and it wasn't until everybody was happy and the developer was out there week after week coming back, he'd met with so-and-so, they'd agreed on these many trees and where they were going to be, and until everything was set, that it didn't go through. And then it did go through, and everybody, I believe, was happy. I hope they were. And finally, I just came back fresh from a subdivision week, a day of sitting and listening to subdivision state stuff, and I believe that a conversion from this into different separate living units would constitute another review under the subdivision ordinance. So we have another whole shot at it, so to speak.
Thank you, Ms. King. I'd add one thing to the fact that we are working under a set of ordinances and we are working under rules and regulations, and that is all true. But one thing we can't do is cover everything with ordinances and rules. And I think the public hearing process is extremely important to this whole program. I don't want to play down the importance of your coming tonight and giving us input, because we do this in a public forum for a very particular reason. We need your input. We can't enforce the comprehensive plan or the ordinances without knowing what the public feels about that. And while we're not empowered to change any of those, we certainly can take into account your feelings on specific issues related to those ordinances in the comprehensive plan. So I think your coming tonight is an extremely important part of the democratic process, and it makes it all happen. I have one or two other questions, and then I think we're going to have to move on this issue. When we took the sidewalk, I asked the question, number one, about tracing the public access to the facility. And I don't know whether anything's been done to show that in any more detail. And before you answer that, there was another question which may have been answered, Maureen, and that was the access by foot to the property from the Elizabeth Park area is through an opening that we started our sidewalk at. And I had a question on whether that was an emergency access point. Has that ever been established? Is that one of the emergency access?
I've reviewed all the documents I can find on the Elizabeth Park project, and that doesn't appear to be an access.
It does not.
It appears just to be a road that was supposed to lead into the abutting lot if the development was extended into that area.
Okay. But we're now converting that to a walkway, not a road.
Right.
Right. Okay.
Well, the applicant will be developing a walkway to the property line, and the existing road will stay where it is.
Okay. So it'll be a road in Elizabeth Park and become a walkway on this property. Is that accurate?
Yes.
Okay. What about public access to the rest of the property? Has that been worked out as far as trails? Will they be marked, so to speak, and will they have public access?
The existing site plan here.
We plan on linking together the Conservation Commission's network of trails with the walkways that we have on our site, so that it'd be free access. And Frank can show you specifically where the walkways will be, but that's the intent, to link it all together.
A number of trails presently on the property, and they all seem to converge in approximately the footprint of the house. What I will be doing is taking this long trail coming in, diverting it probably at this point away from the project, and connecting it with this existing trail in this area, approximately like that, so that you could walk across the site without having to be close to the project or any improvements and still be in the wild area.
Will it be possible to get that marked on some of our copies in some dark, legible pen?
Or
is it already done?
There are a number of T's to be crossed and I's to be dotted, and we are hoping to have a number of revisions and just a resubmission to the planning board on January 4th, which point that would be included.
Will that be included?
Yes, it will.
Along with the draft market feasibility study. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
We can have the market feasibility study ready for you next week.
Okay.
No, I did meet with the fire chief, and I did ask the question about that right-of-way stub and how important that was for access across there. He did not seem to have a problem with what we were proposing, understanding that a wood fence is really not much of an obstacle to a large truck when it's moving through if it had to. He did not particularly object to the proposed buffering we're in, limiting only to pedestrian access there.
Okay. All right. Yes, Ms. McGough.
Just one comment, and that is to underline what's been said before about financial stability. I really would like to ask First Atlantic to give specific consideration to what kinds of financial information you could give us. I know that it's a sensitive area, but I hope you will really...
I think the two strongest banks in Maine right now, well, I don't know if anyone here works for a bank, so I don't offend anybody. From what I understand, Fleet Bank and People's Bank are probably one of the strongest couple of banks in the area, and I can give you names of anyone from the president of each bank down to the loan officers dealing with any of our projects, and those are our two lead banks, People's and Fleet. Roger Castingway at Fleet, and Bill Ryan, People's, Rick Vale at People's, Tom Pelletier at Fleet, Butch Canan. Any of those people can give you specifics or a letter regarding our financial condition and ability to finish the project.
And you'll be submitting that also with your study for this next meeting?
If you were requesting us to do so...
Yes, yes, I think we are. I think you should get the sense, if we're not, we can clearly make it that way, that we would like that kind of information.
That's fine.
Okay. At this point, I think what we'd like to do is, of course, entertain a motion from the board as to where we stand with this application at this point in time. And I think we have a motion before us. And then I would ask our planner to summarize the comments from this evening's, with our secretary's help, from this evening's hearing, so that the applicant has the benefit of all our notes. I'm sure he probably kept pretty careful notes himself, but has the benefit of all our notes, which will become requests in some form for additional information in some of those areas. So we'll try to get that to you also, so that you'll have that to work with.
Oh, great. Thank you.
Do I have a motion? Ms. Kane.
Be it ordered that the application for site plan review of the Elizabeth Heights Retirement Community, a 60-unit congregate care facility located in the vicinity of Scott Dyer Road and Longfellow Drive, is tabled to the regular January Planning Board meeting.
Is there a second? Any discussion on this motion? All those in favor? Opposed? It's tabled to the meeting. We'll be looking for that additional information in enough time so we can give it some careful study. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Next item on our agenda is the sign ordinance. Once again, a public hearing. I would ask the people who came for this prior, session to please exit quietly so we can move on with our business. We have a full agenda tonight. Thank you. And please carry your conversations on outside the hall. Thank you. Thank you. Could we just have a quick review of the sign ordinance and the revised language that we are now faced with? Just an update and an overview, basically.
The purpose of the sign ordinance, which you have before you, is to do two things. One is to update the existing sign regulations to reflect the town's current custom and practice. The second one is to protect the existing town character from the potential of excessive signage. What you have before you is replacing zoning ordinance provisions, which are included in the definition section, which are included in the permitted activities in particular zones, and which also talk about the requirement for a permit from the Board of Zoning Appeals for temporary signs. Briefly, the ordinance includes a provision for definitions. It talks about signs permitted in all districts. Signs, for example, that would be permitted in all districts include traffic signs, temporary signs, political signs, home address, real estate signs, produce signs, farm stand signs, notices such as no trespassing, those types of signs. Signs that are permitted in all districts but which require a permit include temporary residential construction signs, residential development signs, signs for home occupations, and for churches. Each of these signs that were just listed require a permit, and the idea is that when you come before a board for the review that you are required to, you would be getting your sign permit at the same time. The next section talks about signs which are in the business zones which require a permit. Those include freestanding signs, wall signs, awnings, and window displays. There are also signs which are not permitted. Those include projecting and suspended signs that are over 6 square feet in area, roof signs, permanent banners, off-premises signs, signs that include colored lights, flashing lights, beacons, moving parts, and also signs that are on motor vehicles that are intended to subvert the intentions of the ordinance. The ordinance also includes a section on special standards, which talks about different things that each sign has to comply with. Bulk requirements, requirement that wall signs complement the wall they're attached to, that freestanding signs have landscaping at the base. There's a provision that signs must be externally illuminated, and that freestanding signs not impair sight distances of motor vehicle operators, that not they not be within 30 feet of a crosswalk. Also, certain BOCA standards are invoked in terms of construction of signs. There are also special sections that talk about signs for shopping centers and signs for gas stations, provision for the proper maintenance of signs, and finally, there's a section that, which basically looks at implementation. If a sign which is a temporary or permanent sign is erected after the ordinance is passed, that shall be removed immediately. There is an option, however, for permanent signs which are in place at this time. Either they can remain in place until such time as they need to be removed, in which case you have to come in with a sign that meets the ordinance, or any sign that's not conforming right now would have to be removed within 5 years. So that's just a real quick summary of what the ordinance is talking about.
Thank you, Ms. O'Meara. That's a real big help. At this point in time, I would open the public hearing phase, and I would invite comments from the public on this ordinance. Are there any members of the public that would like to comment on this sign ordinance? Seeing none, then I will... Yes. I'm sorry? I'm not seeing too well. Yes, sir.
Thank you. I'm Scott Balfour, president of Century 21 Balfour. Going through the ordinance, there's a couple things I think you might want to look at or I want to raise questions about before you do pass it on to the council. One of them is under your definition section. And it says, wherever dimensions of a sign are specified, they shall include frames. And I think you might want to look at that. It causes some specific problems as you go throughout the ordinance. I think it'd be interesting to note the Welcome to Cape Elizabeth sign that was erected fairly recently has 8 square feet of post on that. It's already a 4x6 sign. You add another 8 square feet. I don't think the intention of that is to minimize that type of architecturally interesting postage for a sign like that. It also impacts perhaps on your temporary sign or the real estate sign section where you're allowing 6 square feet per sign. The industry standard, that sign's about okay. I think you're sort of assuming that that sign might be a 3x4. When you have to take into consideration you're talking a lot less than 3x4 if you have to take away the post or the frame for that sign. I think if you were to look at many of the real estate signs out there, a majority of them are hung on post. And you would be putting all the sellers of property in Cape Elizabeth into a position where they had to use signage far less than the industry standard, and you'd also be putting those sellers in a position where they would have to be selective with real estate firms that could accommodate that less than industry standard. The sign also goes through, you create the impression of your 20 square feet in your business district. Again, if you have 20 square feet, you're sort of assuming maybe a 4x5 sign. Yet, if you take signposts like the Welcome of Cape Elizabeth sign, which is 6 inches wide and 8 feet high on both sides, you take 20 square feet, you subtract 8 square feet, it gives you 12 square foot per sign. And again, so instead of getting the 4x5 sign, which I think is the intent of the ordinance, you're ending up with a 3x4. So I might recommend we delete that part where it says where dimensions of a sign are specified, they shall include frames. I don't believe that was the intent, or if it is, I think the sign ordinance is specifically restrictive in part of the places I've mentioned.
Okay.
Also, I don't think it takes into consideration the small business district of Cape Elizabeth. I think I've heard stated before the business district in Cape Elizabeth is less than 5% of the whole town. Any of the businesses, commercial real estate companies in town, their standard signs range between 3x4 to 4x4. And I think restricting them down to the 6 square feet per side is again restrictive relative to many of the industry standards of which we're experiencing here in the greater Portland area. So I think you might make an additional square foot requirement for the business district for real estate signage. And I think a recommendation there might be 4x4. Going into signs permitted where zones about residential subdivisions or housing for the elderly projects or condominiums. Down below in D for churches, you mention it's per frontage, per entrance on streets. I would think you might want to add up in B also per entrance or per frontage, per street. Are you with me there? Mm-hmm. That's on B.
On B?
21-2-2B.
B, okay.
If you refer down to D, church or civic organizations having frontage on two streets may erect one sign on each frontage. You might want to do that similarly above or change it per entrance, because most of your subdivisions you want one egress, more than one entrance. I might ask why on section 21-3-1 what the objection to projecting or suspended signs are. There are many villages throughout the state which perhaps Wiscasset or what have you, that the projected signs are the preferred signs. So I'm just asking the question why there. Ask the question why there. And I do have the illumination. I think we do have a very small business district in Cape Elizabeth. The majority of communities which do not allow internally lit signs are historically significant in villages, perhaps like Main Street Gorham, perhaps Wiscasset or what have you. And I don't think we have that historical significance in the business district to Cape Elizabeth that would require such a restrictive position on not allowing internally lit signs. During the introduction, it was read that any signs that the grandfathering clause should be Alternative B would allow until the sign was to be removed or replaced. The wording says any change. And I think any change could refer to change in color, change in typeset. And I don't think that's what you really mean. I think you do mean, as was stated at the introduction, any removal of the sign in an addition of a new sign. Or perhaps you mean change in the size of the signage. But I think color, maintenance, what have you, could always be issues when you say any changes. So these are some of the things I'm just asking you to look at prior to your submissions, to your recommendations to the town council. And thank you, if you have any questions on...
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. Any other comments from the public? I don't always have a good angle, but if I see none, I will close the public hearing at this point, and I will ask if the planning board has any comments on the present questions that were made or any other comments on this ordinance. Ms. Kane.
I would ask if someone here has a list of all the comments that Scott made. I missed some of them fumbling around. You didn't get them all? Would you be willing to?
Well,
is that possible?
Well, instead of taking the time now, we
do
have it on tape, and so we could probably review that.
Mr. Chair, I have a list.
And okay. We have a list. Okay.
All right, as long as it's available. Okay, sure. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
One particular point that I'd like to, I guess, a couple of issues. On the issue of frame versus support, I think your comments are well taken. It also depends on how one defines frame. Does a frame mean just that thing that holds a freestanding sign, perhaps, or does it in fact mean the supports on a sign that's attached to the ground? If there is a concern I think the planning board should send to the council regarding this is that while the again, perhaps examples work better than the ordinance itself, but if there's a concern, we're not concerned about the scale of the supports that are provided with the Cape Elizabeth sign. However, in the past, there have been automobile dealerships where the supports exceed the sign itself, and that's a fine line between where that can actually be a nice-looking sign, but that's a way around this ordinance that I would be very concerned about. So I don't know how we're going to adjust that. In terms of internal illumination in the historic district, the town center really is an unusual situation. The town center, Main Street 90 group, has done a lot of work trying to reinforce the notion of a town center, and I think for the foreseeable future, the term notion is appropriate. It's not Wiscasset, but on the other hand, if we as planners don't think beyond next week, if we don't hold a vision for say, a 20-year time frame, then no one else in town certainly has that obligation. So I at least consider a vision where perhaps as development patterns occur over the next 20 years, the town center will become more of a town center than we see now. And if the best we can do is prevent it from becoming a strip like many of the streets in Portland and most communities in the state of Maine, I think we will have gone a long way with this sign ordinance. And the issue of freestanding sign was brought up at the workshop. We were as surprised by it as you were, those that are perpendicular to the building. And I think the concern that came from that discussion was that signs that are perpendicular to the building that are out of scale to the building, many, many large internally illuminated signs that overpower a street, and what will eventually happen is the sign in front, as they get further back, they get progressively larger and brighter. So we elected to permit signs that are mounted perpendicular to the building, but specify a size for that, which would be consistent with the village notion. That's my comments.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Any other comments from the board?
Mr.
Dretzel, yes.
Mr. Balfour mentioned, I think, and maybe I didn't understand him correctly, but I think he said that there was an industry standard for sale signs being the size of either 3x4 or 4x4. And I just, I can't, pardon?
That was for commercial.
Okay. I was quickly trying to think through different franchise businesses that have signs that big. A lot of this, I think, and it's difficult to envision this ordinance as it applies to the charge of the comprehensive plan and what's foreseen for the business district over the next 10 years and for the town of Cape Elizabeth. I think it's an important ordinance because I think it has a great deal of influence on what takes place in the next decade. And it, part of it comes down to is the signage in the town of Cape Elizabeth in Cape Elizabeth style, or are we looking for Cape Elizabeth in the style of different franchises, whether they're oil companies, real estate companies, whatever, that dictate certain logos and design. I think the comprehensive plan is reasonably clear in that the intent is to develop some type of village style to the downtown Cape Elizabeth area. I feel kind of uneasy about certain sections of this. I feel uneasy about the supporting just the externally lit, the externally illuminated signs. I'm not sure that that's the best route. I think we can do a lot to create a village, or at least a Cape Elizabeth style, if that's the intent, by having some ordinance control over size, illumination, style. I'm concerned that we might be attempting to send on to the town council an ordinance that isn't specific about how we tend to deal with the non-conforming use. And I think we need, I'd like to hear more discussion, more board member input as to how we, should we leave it open-ended with two alternatives? Should we, as a board, take some type of, by consensus, stand on how we approach that? I do, however, a couple of the comments from the public on the changes to the sign for each entrance. I think that's only fair. This town tries to get more than one access, in other words, away from the dead-end street, and we should not limit the number of signs per subdivision. It should be by entrance. And the comment on the projecting and suspended signs, I think that's true. A lot of us mentioned in the workshop and in the last meeting that actually in many instances is the preferred type of sign, but it needs some limitation as to the size, and that was the intent of the rewriting of that. Those are the, one other question that I have, and it was brought up at the council public hearing. It was still not made clear to me. Under sign standards for gasoline stations, 214-3, A, paragraph 2, talks about service bay identification signs, and it talks about no more than 10 square feet per area of a total of 120 feet in area. And then under B, the total allowable permanent signage is a total of 120 square feet in the aggregate. Is that in addition to the 120 feet in paragraph 2, or is that inclusive of that one? In other words, for the entire service gasoline station site, is the total allowable 120 square feet?
I've interpreted it to be a total of 120. I don't know what the intention was. Maybe I interpreted it. And I'd like to add a point on the page 8, the alternate D. I think in our workshop we came to the conclusion that there had to be something to account for the fact that the sign might be maintained. And we didn't want to be so restrictive that if somebody went out and changed a light bulb, for example, that all of a sudden that meant that the sign had to be replaced. So that's why alternate D, I believe, came about. and whether we succeeded or not with that alternate, I'm not sure. But what we're trying to say here is that when the sign makes a significant change, it's going to be something more than a light bulb being changed. That's when we would like to see the whole thing change. So that was an attempt at it. Maybe it's not the best attempt, but that was what the reason why D was put in, as I understood. Maureen, do you have something to add to that? Or
I'm not sure. Mr. Balfour has heard the new language.
Oh, okay.
But the way we described a change to the sign, that any permanent sign not conforming with the standards of this ordinance at the time of its enactment may continue until such time that any change other than normal maintenance, which shall include activities that keep the sign in safe, presentable, and sound structural conditions, such as replacement of defective parts, periodic cleaning, and painting, is made to the sign. So the intent would be that things you have to do to keep it in good shape, and one of the things that's required by this ordinance is maintenance of your signs. If you were to replace defective parts, replace light bulbs, replace broken parts, clean it or repainted it, that would be considered normal maintenance.
Are we at the point now where we could entertain a motion related to this ordinance? And I understand that we have a lot of loose ends and suggestions that we'd like to forward along with the ordinance, possibly to the town council. But I'd like to see, are we at the point now where we can do that? So I guess I'm asking, is there a motion that we can make along these lines?
Mr. Chairman, before a motion is made, I'd like to try one more time to see if there's other comment from the board as to should we choose one alternative and advise the council on either D or alternate D, and not simply send them. You make a choice. I think they look to us for some guidance, but maybe we should send them.
I would make a suggestion maybe that you include that in your motion. If you'd like to do that, we can vote on it. Specify which alternate.
I would request that the board, in any additional comments that they would want to make that aren't written in what you have in front of you, be included as amendments or somehow in your motion so that it's clear what you are recommending to the council.
Okay, fine. Anybody want to take a stab at it?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the draft of the sign ordinance dated December the 18th, 1990, that is before us, be forwarded to the town council with the following additions and corrections. That in section 21-1-2 of the definitions, that the last sentence be deleted. That sentence now reads, wherever dimensions of a sign are specified, they shall include frames. That in section 21-2-2, D as in dog, that the word frontage in the second sentence be changed to entrance. And that in alternative D of section 21-5-2 on the last page, the removal of nonconforming signs, that the word substantial be inserted before the word change in the third line so that it would read, may continue until such time that any substantial change other than normal maintenance, etc., is made to the sign. I would further recommend that both D and alternative D be stated as they are now with that one modification, but that the planning board recommend that alternative D be the section which is inserted. I believe that both sections should be set forth so that it's very easy to see that this is one of the most sensitive areas of the
ordinance and that the council would be invited to put specific emphasis on that. That's the end of the motion.
Is there a second?
Second motion.
Second. Is there any discussion, or in this case, maybe any additions, which we would have to, of course, amend our motion on, but are there any others? Ms. O'Meara, did you see any that we've missed hearing on taking?
No, the Mr. Balfour did mention something regarding clarifying what frames means, and I think we took care of that. I don't see anything else.
Okay. We have I'm sorry, Judy.
It wasn't clear to me in this motion if section 21.2.2 subsection B, we were going to add that residential developments and so forth have one sign per entrance also, such as the churches were allowed down below in subsection D.
The motion only included part B, part D as in dog.
D as in dog. Was that the intention? I think that's a reasonable addition to change it.
Okay. Do you accept that amendment?
I do.
Okay. Anything else? We are amending it then to include B under 21-2-2 in addition to D. Okay, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of the motion as it's been drafted plus amendments made tonight, please signify by raising the right hand. Opposed? Let it show that we had, I guess, four and one opposed. Moving on at that point. Thank you. Next item would be our health facility zoning text change. Public hearing once again under section 19-4-9. I'd open a public hearing at this point in time, and I would once again ask our planner to give us an overview of the issues in this particular zoning text change and possibly also a little bit of insight into recommendations by our town attorney related to this.
This application is before the board at the request of Mr. Tom Tinsman, who is applying to build a health facility in the VA zone. Currently, athletic and recreational facilities are allowed in the VB zone. What the approach has been is to define both athletic and recreational facilities, which are not currently defined in the ordinance, and then to permit recreational facilities in the VA zone. There are three separate types of additions that are being proposed to the zoning ordinance. The first one is to add definitions to the definition section. There would be one definition for recreational facilities, primarily a facility which promotes indoor activities. A second definition would include athletic facilities. That's a larger type of facilities, include stadiums and facilities which accommodate spectators. A third definition is proposed, which is a definition for height. As part of the review of a health facility in the BA zone, there has been a concern raised about a maximum height. So a definition of how to measure height is being proposed to add to the ordinance. The next section talks about height itself. What currently exists in the town is that height is limited by the building code, and it's limited by the type of building. Wood frame structure would have a maximum height of 35 feet. However, it's conceivable that a health facility would be other than wood frame construction. And there was a concern that 35 feet was probably an appropriate height in the BA zone at this time, regardless of the type of construction. So there's an amendment proposed to limit building height in the BA zone to 35 feet. Finally, there was some concern about parking. The town engineer has recommended that based on experience and by his traffic engineers and on related studies that a parking requirement of one space per 250 square feet of building is recommended. He has also suggested that if the applicant submits information that shows what actual experience is or what the expected demand is in this facility, that this number be revised to incorporate that information. There finally has been a significant amount of discussion regarding whether a recreational facility should be a permitted use or a conditional use in the BA zone. At this time, it is the town attorney's recommendation that the planning board should not be issuing conditional use permits. Therefore, if this is a conditional use, the applicant would have to go to the zoning board of appeals, and then afterwards to the planning board for site plan review. The town attorney has also recommended that if the board is concerned about specific aspects of this facility, that it would like to make it a conditional use, then those specific concerns should be attached to the zoning ordinance amendment. Otherwise, the Board of Zoning Appeals will not have the guidance and the direction on what they should be looking for and why this was indicated to be a conditional use. Alternatively, this could be described as a permitted use in the BA zone, which would mean that an applicant for a health facility would only have to come to the planning board for site plan review. Again, town attorney is recommending that if there are specific concerns that the board has about this type of facility, that those specific concerns be articulated in the ordinance as specific requirements. It has been the practice in the board of the last two zone changes that in addition to permitting a particular use in a zone, they've also outlined specific requirements. These requirements are not only helpful to the board in allowing them to review a project, they also provide guidance to an applicant. What our town attorney is recommending is that when an applicant reads an ordinance, they should have a general sense of whether their project is something that is considered to be allowed in that zone. So what we have before us are a series of amendments. The last section, section 19.24, permitted uses, there's an alternate. Whether the facility should be a conditional use and go to the Zoning Board of Appeals, or whether it should be a permitted use and stay with the Planning Board. However, with each of those alternates, there could be specific requirements that are attached.
Thank you, Ms. Mayor. Yeah, I think this sets the tone for how we want to review this, and we've gotten some guidance here from our legal people, and I think at this point in time, I would open the public hearing, and I would invite comments from the public on this zoning text change. Are there any comments from the public at this time? Yes. So please come forward and identify yourself.
My name's Diane Joyce. I live at 2 Fenway. I have 2 Fenway Road. I have four boys, so we're involved in a lot of sports here and there. I don't know anything about the height and all. I'm going to tell you what I think. The school is having a tough time, and we're going to lose a lot in our school sports activities to put the children in. I had one of my older children in an activity last year at the high school weightlifting class, and I was amazed when I went to pick up my child at this weightlifting class that it was held in the corridor of the bottom of the high school. I mean, we're talking a hallway. This is where these kids went for an hour and a half to 2 hours to learn to physically work out with their bodies, learn to do what's good with it, and I was pretty discouraged that, you know, it's not the facility in the Cape isn't here. I hate to every time want to take my kids into something that I have to leave a Cape. I mean, we have basically what we need here, and I like to see a facility here where I can send my boys up to do a sport, indoor sport, basketball, or whatever they choose, and then a place to go work out, my husband and I and my children. And I don't see that it's in the center of the town, but it's in an ideal location. It's next to the schools, which most children and adults, that's where we're basically all around that area. So I think it's in a good location. And I just really feel strong that it's something that we need in Cape. And I'd like to see it go through and be able to stay out here instead of commuting back and forth. And I think it's going to be a good support for the kids to get them off the street, give them something structured to do to work out their physical activities and not outside where we don't want them being. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I entertain more comments from the public, I want to remind you that what we're considering here is a zoning text change to an ordinance. In a sense, we're not reviewing a specific project. While I realize that this zoning text change came as a result of a specific project, and it may seem like we're doing a project review, What we're really talking about is far more far-reaching than that, because we're talking about the change to an ordinance, which could affect many, many projects in the future. So while we have received a significant amount of correspondence related, once again, to the specific application, so I think that's helpful. But once again, I'd like you to also think about the fact that this is an ordinance that's being changed, and it's going to affect things that go on in the future also. So I'll stop talking and ask for more comments from the public. Yes, sir.
My name is Morris Kreitz. I live at 126 Fessenden Road. My comments are very brief. First of all, as well as I can understand the situation, recreation facilities are permitted now in the BB zone, but not specifically in the BA zone. And it's not at all clear to me why there should be a distinction between those two zones with regard to recreation facilities. The other comment I would have is that I think that a health facility is, in fact, a recreation facility in today's world, and that there really should be no doubt that a health facility be included in the definition of recreation facilities as is proposed here. I thank you.
Thank you, sir. Any other comments from the public? Sir.
My name is John McDonald, and I live on Peebles Cove Road. And I also agree with what this gentleman has just comments he's made regarding the ordinance. And I also would like to just make my voice known that I support the project that's being put forward here. I think it's important. I think it's important to the youth of the community. I, too, send my son to South Portland High School to do weight training. Do that Tuesday and Thursday evenings. And I'd like to see it happen right here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Further comments?
Chairman, members of the board, my name is Barry Zimmerman. I live at 4 Winding Way. I have helped Tom a little bit with this process, and recognizing what the chairman has said about that we're not to comment upon whether this is a good facility or a bad facility, I'll reserve my comments about what I think the town needs and focus just a little bit on what I think the recommendations in the comprehensive plan were for the town of Cape Elizabeth, which I think is pertinent to this discussion. And it seems to me, very briefly, that when you read the recommendations in the comprehensive